good to see you this morning. Let's go ahead and stand up. It's gonna be a good day, y'all.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Who the Son sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I
opportunity to let all the noise die down from the week, from this morning, and to connect with our Father. And we know that when we come together, when two or more are gathered, He is here with us. And so this next little amount of time, when we connect our heart to His, we call that time prayer, praise, and worship. And so I want to invite all of you this morning that as the band plays, to close your eyes, to focus on Jesus, to focus on His presence, and to connect your heart with His. And maybe for some of you, this is the first time anybody's invited you to do that. Maybe it feels a little weird. So maybe for you, this is a moment where you go, okay, God, reveal yourself to me. I believe He's here. If you don't quite feel Him yet, I believe He'll show up. So let's connect our hearts. And when you're ready, we'll start to sing, and we'll sing with confidence, knowing that His presence is here among us.
Open up my heart to you. Open up, I open up my heart. He will
what he will do.
Yeah, amen. You know, I love that. I love that song so much because it's so personal for me and it's personal for us. And not because it's a great song, which I think it is. Zach, I think it's a great song. Good job. But it's more than just a great song to us. It's our prayer. It's the prayers we've been praying. We've been asking God, would you give us prayers from your heart for your people? And it's what I love about it is that the song is ours. It's for us. It's for CrossPoint. It's for our city. And that's just our prayer, that we would continue to watch and see what God does. When we sing, "You Better Get Ready for a Miracle, for Revival," we believe it, and we feel like God has given us these songs. And I just want to thank you for everybody. We decided a while back, so many of you asked, hey, these songs we sing on Sunday, we want them during the week, and so our team put some music together for you with really the only purpose to give it to you and so you can have it for your worship throughout the week. And then so many of you on Friday downloaded it and got it. And so we want to encourage you to do that if you haven't got it yet. And again, it's just to help you in your worship throughout the week. But I just want to pray that. I want to pray that continues just to be our prayer and our anthem. Would you pray with me? Jesus, thank you that you care about our prayers and that we can trust in your faithfulness. We can trust in your goodness and your kindness to us. And we believe that not only what we're praying for, not only is it coming, but we're seeing it come to fruition. We're seeing your move in our lives, and we're just grateful. We're grateful. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. You all go ahead and have a seat. And we're really glad you're here. If we haven't met, my name is Drew, and I get to serve as a creative pastor here. I just want to welcome everyone, and especially if you're new here to Nashville, I want to welcome you to our Nashville campus. And I also want to welcome everyone online in the chat. I get to host. I'm running back and forth today. I'm actually hosting the chat, too. So I just want to say welcome to everyone in the chat, specifically Megan from Ohio. We know you're dealing with some sick kiddos this week, and we're praying for you. We're glad that you're a part of this worship experience today. We get to give to the Dollar Club today. If you don't know what the Dollar Club is, it's about once a month. We give a dollar above and beyond our normal tithes and offerings. And we find a need or a project or something going on in the world, and we fill that need. And it's always a special time for us because really it just teaches that principle of generosity. We get to do good together. And so today, we'd encourage you, if you want to be a part of that, you just give an extra dollar and come back next week, and we'll share a story of just something we get to do together. So I'm going to invite our greeters to come as we just continue in our worship that way. And it's really a part of who we want to be. The reason why we do the Dollar Club really is just to teach generosity, to teach the fact that if we all do our part, we can do some amazing things together. And that's not just locally, not just through the Dollar Club, but that's around the world. We've been talking about the last couple weeks about some of the trips and some of the initiatives we've got going on all over the globe. And I want to invite you into that as well, to pray about what trip you want to go on. And for us, we like to find partners that are doing amazing things in places in the world, especially unreached places in the world, and come alongside those partners to help really empower the local people there. And one of our new partners is World Relief in Cambodia. We're really excited about partnering with them. It's a brand new partner for us. And one of the reasons why we're excited about it is because only 2% of their populations is Christians. And so they're really reaching a really unreached people group. And we love the stories that come from our partner, stories like Kia. And I want to tell you just briefly for a minute about Kia, because through World Relief, her and her husband were saved. And that's a big deal when it's only 2%. Because the reason why it's a big deal is because she immediately gets ostracized. And Kia was telling us, like, man, I'm losing hope. I'm feeling alone. But she was really tied closely with World Relief. And so one thing that we love is part of empowering her is that she was actually going to nutrition classes and learning how to really feed her family. And then she was taking these classes. She was going back into the village and then training other people on just dietary needs and fighting against malnutrition. And because of that, the community welcomed her back in and welcomed her back in, even though she served a foreign god, as they would say. They welcomed her back in, and she's finding that she's being welcomed back into her community, her people again. It's just amazing the things that God. And we tell you this story because it's easy to get lost in just kind of the magnitude of what we're doing. But it's about the one. It's about the Kias around the world that are doing amazing things, that we want to continue to partner with organizations like World Relief that empower people like Kia to go and make a difference in her world. So we want to invite you into that. We want to invite you to take a trip. And you might sit there and say, well, why don't we just send them money and let them do it? And we do that. A portion of what you give so generously goes to supporting our partners. But a couple things happen when we go. The first thing is that it allows our partners and our organizations to know that they're not alone in this. We can go and help and support them and give to them. But there's this beautiful thing that happens when we go where God does something in us. It changes who we are, and then we come home and live different. So not only do we get to help people around the world, but we come home and we just become better husbands, fathers, wives, coworkers, all those things. And so we want that for us. It changes Nashville, changes our cities when we go and serve. And so we invite you just to pray about being a part of that. It's easy to find out more information and to sign up. You go to crosspoint.tv/global and see all the places we're going over the next year or so. Or if you just want to talk to someone specifically, feel free to stop by the kiosk in the lobby. You'll see the big red banner that says Global Good on it. We have volunteers out there just anxious to talk to you a little bit more about what trip you might want to go on over the next year. Well, today we wrap up our series called Awaken. We've been in this 30 days of prayer and fasting, and in the stories that God is already bringing in and what he's doing in our cities is incredible. I got a little sneak peek of Pastor Kevin's message today, and I'm telling you, you're going to want to take notes. I mean, some of the stuff he's going to share in you is just mind-blowing what God is doing. I'm so excited for us. So let's lean in as we finish up our series called Awaken.
There's an uncommon unity that is in this city. We say more of that, God, more unity among the churches, because when Jesus looks at the church of Nashville, he sees his church.
Welcome to CrossPoint and our final weekend of the Awaken series. Now, we close out the Awaken series today, but the Awaken season continues in that we've got a gathering on Wednesday night called One Church. We'll pull all five campuses together at the Nashville campus, and we will worship in one room together. And so I want to invite you to be with us. It's going to start at 6:30, and we'll have kid programming for up to third grade, and then everybody else will be in here together. So I hope you can make arrangements in your calendar, and you can join us for that. It'll be an incredible night of worship as we celebrate all that God's been doing over the last 30 days. And I just want to say, CrossPoint, I'm so proud of you in the way that you've pressed into the heart of God through prayer and through fasting through these 30 days as we've been praying for Nashville by name. We've joined together with over 415 churches. I'm just proud of the way that you've locked arms with all these other churches, and we're praying for Nashville and the metro area by name. And it's just been, it's been incredible. And I'm telling you, when you look back through history, you never see an awakening that didn't first come through united prayer. See, united prayer is what we do, and then the awakening is up to God. United prayer is stacking the wood. It's God that brings the fire. And so it feels like stacking wood. When you're praying through a list of 15 people that you don't know by name, it feels like stacking wood. 30 days of praying through people. And isn't it crazy how you began praying for strangers on a piece of paper, but over time, if you've been joining us, you can just, like, your heart is connected, like they're just friends you haven't met yet. And I'm not encouraging you to go to their house and their address and go meet them. I'm not encouraging you to do that. But when you write a postcard, I mean, it's not just an exercise. It's not just something you do. It really is. It's a connection of the heart, and your prayers matter. I don't know that we will know until we get to heaven just how much our prayers have mattered. I mean, I can just imagine in heaven. I mean, I think heaven is a place where we connect all the dots between the things we do here on this earth and how they impact eternity. I see you in heaven eating brisket, and you're eating brisket. Just imagine you're eating. And if you've been fasting for 30 days, that sounds pretty good right now. Think about eating some brisket, and you're up in heaven. I don't know if it's Martin's or Edley's. I don't know what it is, but you're eating brisket in heaven. And imagine that a lady walks over to you, and she introduces herself, and she says, "My name is Karen, and I'm from Hermitage. And I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for praying for me for those 30 days. Because you prayed for me, I found Christ. And here's my husband and my kids, and they found Christ too." And you'd be like, "What?" You say, "Come on, eat some brisket. It's Martin's without the line. You don't have to wait in line." And just go. But can you imagine? And I don't know that we'll know until heaven all of the significance and all of the stories of the prayers that have been prayed. But I know we're already seeing the impact. We're already seeing the impact in that 2 weeks ago, over 150 people were baptized across all the campuses of CrossPoint. Over 150 people went public with their faith. That's okay. It's okay to clap your hands. That's appropriate. And we celebrate with heaven over every decision that was made, every life that was changed. And I heard last week there was a college student at Dixon, college age girl. She came forward and she said, "I missed the baptism, but I want to be baptized." So they filled up the tub just for her to be baptized last weekend. And I love that. I love that. And so that joins like with a prayer where I've been praying, God, would our water bill spike as a church because we're having to fill up the tub every single week. Because we're having to fill up the tub because people who have been prayed for are saying yes to God, turning their lives over to him. I remember after one 5:30 service, I had a young man came up to me, and his name was Evan. And he said, "I want to follow Jesus and be baptized." And he was yoked. And he said, "I want to follow Jesus and be baptized." I said, "Man, tell me your story." He said, "I grew up Jehovah's Witness, and after I left Jehovah's Witness, I lost my family. And I lost my friends, I lost all my relationships, and I've just been lost for a couple years now." And he said, "I'm a trainer at the gym." I'm like, "I can see that." He said, I'm a trainer at the gym." And he said, "I've had some clients and I've had some mentors who have told me you need to go to CrossPoint." He said, "So I started coming to CrossPoint and I've been listening and God's been working in my heart and I want to follow Jesus and be baptized." And I said, "Man, that's great. We're going to get out the calendar. We'll find a date." He said, "No, I want to be baptized tonight." And I said, "Yes." Okay, because he was strapped. I was like, "Absolutely." And so he got baptized. He got baptized that night. And here's what I want you to see. The Holy Spirit does not procrastinate. Holy Spirit does not procrastinate. And that we have a here and now kind of God. And he works in the lives of people one at a time. And he's waking up this city. He's waking up our churches one person at a time. There is a movement that's going across Middle Tennessee. And you don't want to sleep through it. We don't want to be asleep for what God's doing. That's why the series, that's why it's called Awaken, because we want to be fully awake to what God's doing. There's a verse in the Proverbs, and it says, "The one who gathers in the summer is a wise son, but he who sleeps in harvest brings shame upon himself." And we're saying, God, we don't want to sleep in the harvest. We don't want to be asleep. And my prayer for you is that we would be fully awake to who God is, and we'd be wide awake to what he's doing around us, that we wouldn't sleep through it. And so we're going to start a series next week called Rise and Shine. Because here's what I know is that every day we rise, but not every day we shine. Some of you are not morning people, and you know exactly what I'm talking about. But it goes beyond not being a morning person. It goes beyond into our lives. We say, God, we want to shine. We want to radiate your glory. We want others to see Christ in us. And so we're going to be going through Romans chapter 12 together, talking about how we can rise and shine. Look at just real practical things that we can build into our day to help us radiate, to help us shine in our lives. But the scary thing about being asleep is that you can be asleep and not know it until you wake up. I know this from experience, because when I was in ninth grade, I had trouble because I would fall asleep in Ms. Davis's class, and I would fall asleep in her class because she had film strip Friday. I mean, there were DVDs in that day, but she still showed film strips. And the film strips also had a tape player, but she used a record player. That's just how ancient her technology was. And sometimes I would put tapes in the record player because she wasn't really good at hearing. And so I would put tapes in the tape player on the film strip and played. I played the whole Vanilla Ice B-side on. That's a whole nother sermon and talk. But I remember one day it was film strip Friday and I fell asleep. And when I fell asleep, have you ever fallen asleep on both arms? Like, you've got a couple choices in class, and students, this is just for you, so you can take notes. You can do like this and try to hide your eyes from other people, and you can fall asleep like this. Or you can turn your head like this, and you can fall asleep like this. Now, this is a less risky move than this. And the reason this is so risky is because you can fall asleep on both arms. And when you fall asleep on both arms fall asleep. Anybody ever had that happen? That's a freaky moment, because you don't know, like, are they going to come back? Like, both arms are asleep, and you're looking at them. And I remember one after one, I woke up, and I was like, my arms are asleep. And everybody's getting up to leave class, and I'm like, I can't move my arms. I can't get my bag. I can't get up. I'm trying to figure out how to, right? And so I just had to wait to wake up. And it's funny when it's your arms, but it's not funny when it's your heart. Because when you're spiritually asleep, it's like your heart goes to sleep. It's like you lose sensitivity to the things of God. You lose your passion for life and you lose compassion for other people. and you no longer sense his presence. And you know what? We can be asleep in our hearts our entire lives. And that's why Jesus came. He came to wake us up. He came to wake us up one at a time, to awaken us, to fill our hearts with his love, to touch us in our hearts, and to wake us up to who he is. And over the past weeks, we've been talking about three stories that he told to wake us up. A story of a lost sheep and a lost coin and a lost son. But Jesus wants to wake us up to who God is. And in those stories, he wants to wake us up to how much God values people who have lost their way. As we've talked about in the series, when Jesus used the word lost, it was a term of endearment. It wasn't a derogatory term. He was saying, there's someone that I care deeply about. And when you value something, then it can be lost. What Jesus is saying is that every person who has lost their way is valued by him. Now, I got a question, just kind of show of hands. How many of you lose stuff? How many of you say it's a problem in your life? This is confession and it's good for the soul, right? Hands up. How many of you don't lose things and the people that just raise their hands get on your nerves? How many of you are those people? And you're just self-righteous enough to raise your hand? No, I'm just kidding. All right, they're just being honest. Like, I'm in the first group. I lose stuff all the time. And this past week, I lost my bag. And it was my bag had my Bible in it, which is important when you're a preacher. Like, I mean, that's had my Bible in it, and it had my iPad in it. And so in that moment, I realized I can't find my bag. So I start looking like mad through the house, and then I start looking in the car. And then I have this moment where I'm like, am I going to tell my wife that I lost my bag? Because she's in the second group. She's one of those people where everything has its place and everything in its place. And she sometimes might get frustrated that I lose stuff all the time. And so I'm like, I'm not going to tell her. I'm just going to look. And then I hit that frantic panic mode where I'm like, I can't find it. And so finally I humble myself and I take the risk and I say, Ree, have you seen my bag? And the reason I don't tell her is because she always asks this question. She asks the question, well, where was the last place you had it? And I'm like, if I knew that, I wouldn't be asking you, have you seen my bag? But she asked me, she said, when was the last place you had it? I was like, I don't know. That's why I'm asking you, because I can't find my bag. And she said, well, did you take it to the car wash? It's like, I did take it to the car wash. I called the car wash. I was like, hey, did you guys find a little bag? And the guy's like, yeah, we found a bag. I was like, hold on to the bag. I get my car and I'm going to drive the speed limit I get there as fast as I can. And I get to the car wash. I go in and the guy has waited for me because it was raining. It's always awesome when you get your car washed and then it rains, but welcome to Nashville. And so I go inside and the guy's waited for me and he gives me the bag. I hold up, the angels celebrate. Oh, it was this incredible moment. I go back to the car, check, make sure everything's in. I think that was incredible. Now, some of you are judging me right now because you don't lose things, but I feel sorry for you. Because you never know the joy of finding something that you lost. You never hear the angels celebrate because everything has its place and everything in its place. And you don't know what it's like. I'm going to tell you what's better than that is if you're a person who habitually loses things, sometimes you find things you lost that you forgot you lost. $20 in my pocket? We're going to Dairy Queen. I mean, that's just like, you don't know that joy in life. But some of us do. And sometimes you lose things, though, that you could never forget you lost. And that's where we went last week when Annie told the story from Luke 15 about a father who lost two sons. And she taught a mess. If you missed last week, go online. Do yourself a favor. Listen to the podcast. Go on YouTube. Watch the message because it just so communicates the heart of God. I attended the 9 o'clock and the 11 o'clock. I double dipped last week because it was just it's that good. But what Jesus teaches in Luke 15 is that the Father is searching for his lost children. And his heart goes out to those who have lost their way. And what I want to do today is I want to couple Luke 15 and Luke 19. So if you've got a Bible, you can turn to Luke 19. You can look at Luke 19 with me. It's one of my favorite passages. In Luke 15, Jesus has given us the theological information. In Luke 19, he gives us a demonstration. In Luke 15, Jesus says, let me tell you what God is like. And in Luke 19, he says, let me show you. So Luke 19 is what we're going to look at. It's one of my favorite stories. It's the story of Zaccheus. And whether it's your first time or your 100th time hearing this story, I pray that God gives you, the person sitting in your seat, a fresh revelation of his love for you. So we're going to pick up in Luke 19, verse 1. It says, "And Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through, and a man was there by the name of Zaccheus, and he was a chief tax collector and was wealthy." Now, this verse tells us a couple things about Zaccheus. This man Zaccheus, he lived in Jericho, and Jericho is this town, and it's one of the oldest cities. They tell us it's the oldest city in the world, and it was in Jericho that this man Zaccheus lived. And I've got a friend who lives in Jericho. I've visited him a couple times. It's pretty incredible. He lives right down the street from the historical marker of where they said Zaccheus' house was, and so it's pretty crazy. You go for a run, and you're running down the street, and you're like, there's Zaccheus' house. No big deal, but I'm just, you know, going down. And there's a monastery there now, but this is a historical marker. And if you would have told the people in that day that today there would be a historical marker where Zaccheus' house was, they would be horrified, because Zaccheus was hated. He was despised because he was a what? What was his profession? This verse tells us. He was a tax collector. He was the chief tax collector, which means that he betrayed his own people, joined sides with the Roman government, and collected taxes from them. And he was wealthy because he overcharged them. And he was hated. He was despised. He wasn't just a tax collector, he was the chief tax collector, which means that he was the leader of the Jericho cartel. And so he was kind of a big deal, but he was kind of really hated and despised there. And the religious leader said, there's no way that Zaccheus can be saved, that he is beyond redemption, that he is outside of the family. He can't be a child of Abraham. Abraham is not his father, he's out of the faith. And now here's the deal. A couple miles from where Zaccheus' house is, there's another historical location. If you travel down the road, you're going to come to a place where, down this dirt road, a few miles, you get to the spot where they tell us is around where Jesus would have been baptized. It's the spot where John the Baptist was baptizing people. And when John the Baptist was baptizing people, people came from all over to be baptized by him. I want you to look at this verse in Luke 3, 12 and 13. It says, "Even tax collectors came to be baptized. Teacher, they asked, what should we do?" "Well, don't collect any more than you are required to," he told them. So it wasn't a sin to collect taxes. The sin was that they were overcharging. So I want you to imagine this. So you have 100 sheep, 100 goats, and 100 acres. And Rome is charging at a rate of, let's just say, 30%. Well, then what a tax collector would do oftentimes is they would come in and they would charge 50%, and they would take 20% for themselves. And so the sin was that they were overcharging. And what John says is this: just don't overcharge. Well, Zaccheus was into overcharging, and he overcharged a lot. And the problem was that he never had all that he wanted. Because our hearts can never be filled with things. There's this verse in Ecclesiastes. It's Ecclesiastes 5:10. It says, "Whoever loves money never has enough. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with their income." John D. Rockefeller, who was the wealthiest man in our nation, if it was in today's economy, he would have twice the net worth of Jeff Bezos. And so a reporter went to him one time, and he asked him, he said, "How much is enough?" You know what Rockefeller said? He said, "Just a little bit more. Just a little bit more." Our hearts always want just a little bit more, because material possessions can never satisfy eternal longings. You have a space in your heart that is meant for God. And no matter how much you have, it will never fulfill. Wealth is not a bad thing. It can be a good thing. But when a good thing becomes an ultimate thing, that's when it becomes a bad thing. When we orient our lives around wealth, thinking that it will satisfy us. One of my favorite quotes from Jim Carrey is not from Dumb and Dumber. It's from actually Jim Carrey. He said, "I think everyone should get rich and famous and do everything they ever dreamed so they can see that it's not the answer." Now, some of us read that and we're like, "All right, Jimmy, but give me a try," right? I mean, because we think that we can be the exception, but I want you to think with me. I want you to think with me. The most meaningful things in life, the true riches of life, can't be purchased. I just made a list: a good marriage, meaningful family life, friendship, wisdom, peace, contentment, forgiveness of your sins, and eternal life cannot be purchased. I have a old retired chicken farmer that told me one time, he said, Kevin, money won't buy you happiness, but it'll let you choose what makes you miserable. Zaccheus was miserable. Not because of what he had, but because of what he didn't have. And he didn't have people in his life. Because he made the decision to choose money over people. See, he was used to eating nice meals, but he was also used to eating alone. And we all know what loneliness feels like. You can be in a crowd of thousands of people and have a wave of loneliness sweep over you and feel like you're the only one in the room. We all know what that feels like. But the lie that's connected to loneliness, the lie that the enemy wants to lodge in your soul, I came across it this week, not in my study, but in my living room when my son was sick. My son came down with the flu, and at 4 a.m. he came downstairs, and he was on the couch, and I was sitting reading on the other couch, and he yelled out, I want Mimi. Now, here's the problem. Mimi lives in Atlanta. So I'm like, what? I mean, he's never done that before. And then I start walking over. He's like, I want Gramps. Gramps lives in Atlanta, too, with Mimi. And so I'm like, Gramps is not here. He's like, I love Gramps. Now, Dad, if you're listening right now, I'm not saying that to guilt you. I'm just saying he loves you. And so he said, I want Gramps. And I'm like, Gramps is not here either. And then I realize he's asleep. And I'm like, he's asleep. And I start walking. He's asleep. He's like sleep talking. And as I'm walking back to the other couch, I hear him say, nobody wants me. And I run over to him and I wake him up. And I'm like, no, 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 no. I want you. Mommy wants you. Everybody wants you. And I was messed up the entire day because my 9-year-old was talking in his sleep and said, nobody wants me. Because as a father's heart, it broke my heart to think that my child could even think that for a moment and he was asleep. You need to know it breaks your father's heart in heaven that you would ever think that nobody wants you. Breaks his heart to the point where he would send Jesus, where he would send his son to you. And he would send his son to Jericho. Zaccheus, the lie he believed is that nobody wants me. And that's when Jesus shows up. Verse 3 says he wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and he climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him since Jesus was coming that way. Now, not only is Zaccheus a despised tax collector, but he is vertically challenged. Now, we don't know how tall he was. We know that Jesus was 5'9 and a half, which just happens to be how tall I am. So we know that's God's preferred height for humanity. But so Zaccheus was shorter than that. I just made that up, but that's okay. And Luke tells us that Zaccheus does two things, that he goes and that he climbs a tree and that he runs ahead. Those are two things that in that culture, dignified grown men don't do. But he did those things because he wanted to see Jesus. See, only children ran and only children climbed trees and men with childlike faith. So Zaccheus runs ahead and he climbs up the tree. And so he's getting up to a vantage point. And what I want you to see is that his curiosity came from God. Your spiritual curiosity comes from God. Awakening begins with a curiosity, with a sacred curiosity. Curiosity is an act of God. And when you are curious about spiritual things, it's because God is wanting to take you to the next level in your faith. And he's awakening in you. And you're asking questions you didn't ask before. And you're praying when you didn't pray before. And you're opening up the scriptures when you didn't do that before. And here's what I want to encourage you. Let your curiosity drive you to Jesus. Don't stop with anything else. Let it drive you to him. Seek after him. And Zaccheus, he climbs up in the tree. He was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he, and he climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. That was the song that I think is going to do pretty good. It's going to do all right. And so he's up in the tree, and he's looking down, and he sees Jesus. Now look at what happens. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up. Now, if you're in a crowd and somebody looks up, what do? You look up. So in that moment, Jesus looks up, and everybody looks up. So everybody's looking up, and they're like, that's Zaccheus. Is that Zaccheus? And Jesus says, Zaccheus. He calls him by name. He says, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. See, he calls him by name. He knows his name. And he says, I want you to come down because I want to I want to have a meal with you. And in that day, to share a meal was to share table fellowship, which was basically the translation as Jesus saying, Zaccheus, I want to be your friend. I want to be your friend. And what I love about this is he calls him by name. To the man who believed the lie, nobody wants me, God says, I know your name. And I know your address in the tree. And I want you to come down because I want you. I desire you. I made you for a relationship with me. And the God of the universe says that to the person sitting in your seat. He knows you by name. Ladies, with God behind bars, you're not a number. That's not your identity. God knows your name. You may feel anonymous in your job. You may feel forgotten by your family, but you need to know God sees you and he calls you by name. And when these postcards are written to Nashville, when you write these postcards, somebody's going to receive a postcard, and maybe somebody who thinks that they've been forgotten by God and that God doesn't know them and God doesn't care and no one cares, what we're saying with our prayers and what we're saying with these postcards is you matter to God and you matter to us. God sees you. And Zaccheus climbed up a tree to see Jesus. And Jesus climbed down from heaven to seek Zaccheus. And he invites Zaccheus into a relationship. And look at what happens. Verse 6 says, so he came down at once and he welcomed him gladly. I love this. This is the best day of Zaccheus' life ever. Like, he's hurrying down the tree. And he's rejoicing. But then look at what happens. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. Now, not everybody was excited about the breakthrough that Zaccheus just had. When grace shows up on the scene, so do critics. But here's what I want to encourage you. Don't let critics keep you from your breakthrough. From the thing that God wants to do in you and the thing God wants to do through you, don't let critics hold you back. What we learn from this is don't count your critics, weigh them. 1,000 gnats don't weigh more than an elephant. And the elephant in the room is Jesus' opinion of you. And he says, I want you. So no matter what the critics say, you go to Jesus. You seek him. You can't afford to have a thought in your mind about you that's not in God's mind when he thinks about you. And what Jesus thought of Zaccheus is I want to be with you. So he invites him to lunch. And Zaccheus comes down. And we don't know what they ate. Probably brisket. We don't know what happened there. But look at verse 8. It says, but when Zaccheus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay them back 4 times the amount. So something happened in Zaccheus' heart where he's like, okay, I mean, the man who traded everything to get money is now getting a buzz off of giving it away. Like, there's been a change that happened inside of it, and that's what grace does. Grace changes us. And what we have here is called restitution. And restitution is when you give back what you've stolen from others. I've told you before that I was arrested for shoplifting when I was 16, and in the back of a police car is when I gave my heart to Jesus. And it was after that that my dad told me, he said, Kevin, I want you to bag up everything that you've stolen. I want you to take it back to the store managers. And so we drove around with bags of stuff, and I would have to go and talk to a store manager and apologize for it. And it was the most humiliating and humbling thing I've ever done in my life. But it was the most liberating thing, because with every conversation, I was driving a nail in the coffin of my old life. And what restitution does, I mean, I want you to hear what it doesn't do. It doesn't bring your salvation. Zaccheus was not saved because he gave things back. But he gave things back because he was saved. See, restitution does not lead to your salvation, but it will lead to your transformation, to a change. And so Zaccheus was changed, and so he went and made things right. Now, my question for you is, where maybe do you need to bring restitution in your life? Who is somebody that you've wronged that you need to go back and say, I'm sorry? Where is it that you've borrowed something and you've never returned it? What have you stolen that you need to go back and make things right? Where have you tarnished someone's reputation? And you need to go back and have a conversation. See, restitution is the response to the grace that's been given. And Zaccheus, he goes and he makes things right with restitution. Now look at Jesus' response. Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save that which is lost. He's like, Zaccheus, I've been looking for you. And now you've received salvation. Now you're in the family of God. And how did Zaccheus receive salvation? He welcomed Jesus into his life. How do we receive salvation? We welcome Jesus into our lives. Jesus is not going to force himself upon you. He invited himself to Zaccheus' house, but he did not intrude. He is a gentleman. He will not force himself into your life. But when you're ready, when you say yes, that you welcome Christ into his life, when Jesus comes, he brings forgiveness, he brings freedom, he brings grace, he brings truth, he brings new life to you. And it happens the moment you say yes to him. And Zaccheus said yes to him, and Jesus changed his life. And if you'll say yes to him, he will change your life too. And you can't earn it. You just receive it. So before we're finished today, I want to give you an opportunity to do just that. But before I give you that opportunity, I want to tell you a story. And maybe it's the most incredible story that I've heard in this whole Awaken season. Dave Clayton, pastor of Ethos Church, gave me a call. He said, "Kevin, this amazing story." He said, "I just got a phone call from 7 minutes ago from Antioch Church of Christ, and one of the pastors there called and told me the story. He said that on February 13th, a man walked into the church, and his name was James, and he walked in and he said, 'I need somebody to help me find Jesus.' He said, 'The guy that was there said, I'm not a pastor. The pastor's not here. I'm the business guy, but I'll give it a try.' And so he shared Jesus with the man, and the man gave his life to Christ. The guy told him, he said, 'We're having baptisms tonight. If you want to come back and be baptized, you can.' And the guy came back and was baptized. Said on Sunday, there was a family that came into the church, a new family of the church, and they tracked down this businessman from the church, and they said, 'Hey,' they said, 'Did you have a conversation with a man named James on Wednesday?' He said, 'I did.' He said, 'He gave his life to Christ.' And the man said, 'Yes, he did.' 'And he was baptized.' 'Yes, he was.' They said, 'That was our dad.' They said, 'And 2 days after that, he died unexpectedly. Passed away. Dropped dead.' And that family said, 'We need Jesus.' And so he led that entire family to Christ. Now Dave said, 'I got the guy's information and I plugged it into our list. And his name is James and he lived on Irma Drive in Antioch. And there's somebody from CrossPoint. And somebody from Ethos has been praying for him the last 30 days. As you were praying, somebody was praying for him. God was wooing and God was drawing and God was calling James to himself. God heard every one of your prayers. Every meal you gave up. Every sacrifice that was made. It's not in vain. I know in this room, there are people who have been prayed for. There are other people who have been praying for you. And maybe you're this close, but you've never said yes to Jesus. You've never invited him in. You've never received him. You've never welcomed him gladly. And he hasn't given up on you. And today can be the moment where you take spiritual curiosity and you take that next step to salvation. And you find the grace and the freedom and the forgiveness that only Christ can give. And so I want to invite you to that. And I'm not going to ask you to climb a tree. I'm not going to make you come up on the stage. I'm not going to make you do anything. But I'm going to invite you to do something that I don't know that we've ever done before. It'll take courage on your part. But I want to invite you to stand. If you want to receive Jesus, if you want to accept a relationship with him, then I'm going to invite you to stand. Here's what I can tell you. In just a moment, I'm going to ask you to stand. There are a lot of people in this room who are going to celebrate. And we're going to rejoice. We're going to celebrate what Christ has done in your life. But if you want to take that next step like Zaccheus and receive God's grace and be made right with God, receive his forgiveness, his love, and know that relationship with your Heavenly Father, then And I'm going to invite you to do that, just even right now. Across the room, the invitation is to stand. Just go ahead and stand. Come on. It's awesome. Amen. Great. Congratulations. Thank you. Now, I'm going to ask you to stay standing. Now I want to give you just a moment more. Anybody else that would say, I'm in? I see. Anybody else say, I'm in? Okay. Now here's what we want to do. To those who are standing, we want to put a hand on your shoulder to say, you're not alone, and you're not alone, and we are with you. And so if you're around those who are standing up, just put a hand on their shoulder. And kind of gather around him. If you don't like people putting a hand on your shoulder, just knock their hands off. Just do like that. They'll get it. But here's what we're saying. We're saying, welcome to the family of God. Most significant decision you'll ever make. And we are with you in this. We're saying, welcome to the family. And I want to lead you in a prayer. And I want to invite those that are around you as well to whisper this prayer with you. Just so you know, you're not alone. Just to whisper a prayer like this. Say, Father, thank you for loving me. And thank you for sending your son Jesus to die for me. Right now, I receive your grace. I receive your forgiveness. I receive your new life. I want to walk with you here on earth and spend forever with you in heaven. Thank you for saving me. And so, Father, I pray that all of us, and you can have a seat, I pray that all of us would live in the reality of us being found by you. And that we would join you, Jesus, in your mission of helping other people find you as well. That this would just be the beginning of awakening for our city. And God, that we would walk in the courage of whatever you ask us to do. Because we know that you are with us and you are for us and you are working through our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And as you're seated, let's one more time. Thanks to God. Come on.
I just think about how good and how kind God is for us to be able to see, to physically see him moving in people's lives and the life change that happens. Love the scripture that says even when one lost person comes back home, that all of heaven, all the angels rejoice, and we just get to join in that celebration. Man, it fires me up. I feel like I could run through a wall. I'll wait till you leave, though. The whole building might come down. I'm not going to do that, but I just love what God's doing, that we get to be a part of it. And that's what I love about Awaken, is that this is just the beginning. It's not like 30 days of prayer and fasting and it's over. This is the beginning of what we believe God wants to do in our church, in our lives, and in our city. It's amazing to be a part of it. And we're going to, yeah, you back there, I'm with you. And here's the thing, what we're going to do on Wednesday night, it's one church. We hope you come back at 6:30 because we're just going to party. We're going to pray. We're going to worship. We're going to celebrate all that God has done and is doing. And then next Sunday, we start a brand new series called Rise and Shine. It's just a series on purpose and us being intentional with our days. And so before you go, I'd love to pray for you. Would you stand if you're able? Let's pray together. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for what you're doing. We just sense your faithfulness and your kindness to us, and we're grateful. And God, we want to take this love, we want to take what we feel, and we want to take it out with us today into our homes, into our workplaces, into our schools, God, that you may get all the glory. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. We love you guys. Have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday. It'll all be fine this time.